Hello all. Today we are going to discuss about sterility test. So what is basically sterility? Sterility means a process by which you remove all the microorganisms from a pharmaceutical product. So sterility test is basically a test that critically assesses whether a sterilized pharmaceutical product is free from contaminating microorganisms. According to IP, the sterility tests are intended for testing the absence of viable forms of microorganisms in or on the pharmaceutical preparations. Not all the products need to undergo sterility testing. Sterility testing are performed on the product which are directly coming in contact with your body fluids, which are coming in contact with your blood, or which are coming in contact with the direct wounds. So for example, sterility testing needs to be done on products such as injections, implants, syringes, ophthalmic preparations, ointments and creams, basically ointments which are to be put inside your eyes. Next are bandages, which we apply on the open wounds, surgical dressings and devices, and the needles that are used for your syringes. Now, what exactly is the meaning of sterility test? Now, just like I am reading it, this test are based upon the principle that if microorganisms are placed in a medium which provides nutritive material and water and kept at a favorable temperature, the organisms will grow and their presence can be indicated by a turbidity in the originally clear medium. Now, what do you mean by this? Now, take an example of an IV injection. We all are performing sterilization on the IV injection, whether it is in-process sterilization or whether it is terminal sterilization. Now, how can we be sure that the sterilization that we have carried out is perfect? So what we do is, randomly from the batch that we have produced, we select a few, that number is also provided by IPBP and USP. We select a few vials of that IV injection, and the solution that is present inside that IV injection is placed inside a nutrient agar plate or a nutrient agar broth. Now, if that vial that we have selected was contaminated with any microorganism, that microorganism is getting a very conducive environment because of the nutrient medium that we have provided it. So ultimately, it is going to lead to turbidity. So basically, at the end of the experiment, turbidity indicates that your product in that particular batch fails your sterility test. Okay, so basically the interpretation of results is based on the assumption that contents of every container in the batch, had they been tested, would also have given the same results. Since every container cannot be tested, a sufficient number of containers should be examined to give a suitable degree of confidence in the results of the test. Now, just like I said in the previous slides, all the containers that we have manufactured cannot be subjected to sterility test. It's very obvious. If we subject all the containers to the sterility test, we won't be having any batch at the end of the testing, because sterility test is a kind of a destructive test. We cannot regain our product back. So it is not logical to subject all the containers in a particular batch to sterility testing. So IP has suggested few methods by which you can select how many containers are to be subjected to a particular sterility test. So if you look at the table, if you are talking about parenteral preparations, okay, if your batch size is not more than 100 containers. I repeat, if your batch size is not more than 100 containers, then you, from that 100 containers, you are supposed to select 10% or 4 containers, whichever is greater. Okay, now let's take another example. If your batch size is more than 100, but it is not more than 500 containers, so somewhere between 100 to 500 if it is your batch size, in that case you have to select 10 containers out of that batch size to perform your sterility testing. Okay, same way, consider an ophthalmic preparation. If you have not more than 200 containers, you are going to select 5% or 2 containers, whichever is greater. Likewise, you have selection of number of containers for surgical dressings and devices and even for bulk solids. This selection, I repeat, is according to IT. Okay, now we have selected the number of containers. So for example, if we have a batch size less than 100 containers, suppose for example we are selecting 10 containers out of that 100 batch. Okay, now that 10 containers that we have selected could be of 10 ml, 100 ml, 200 ml. How much volume or quantity of that material is to be used to perform the sterility testing? Even that needs to be decided. You cannot randomly select any amount of the container size to perform your sterility testing. So this table tells you how much quantity per container you have to use to perform your sterility test. So for example, if you are working with liquids which are less than 1 ml, so the injection vials that we get in the market, which we have to break open and then take it inside your syringe, those can be less than 1 ml also. So if you are working with an injection vial which is less than 1 ml, you have to use the whole contents of that container to perform your sterility test. Take another example. If you are having a quantity somewhere between 1 ml to 40 ml, so in that case you have to use half the contents of each container, but it should not be less than 1 ml. Okay, now if your container size is greater than 100 ml, so you have to use 10% of the contents of the container, but not less than 20 ml. Okay, so likewise, they have suggested for you how much should be the quantity of the liquids, how much should be the quantity of the solids, how much should be the quantity of the semi-solids. Now, selection of the culture media is very, very important when it comes to sterility test. Now, there are three media that are available. So, first media is called as fluid thioglycolate medium. The composition is given in the table. So, it is called as a fluid thioglycolate medium. So, if you observe the table, it contains an indicator which is called as risazurin. So if you have attended my previous lectures carefully, you will come to know what is risazurin. It's a oxidation reduction indicator. It turns pink in the presence of oxygen. So this particular medium is primarily used if you are expecting that the contaminant in your product is aerobic and anaerobic bacteria. So I repeat, fluid thioglycolate medium will be used for aerobic and anaerobic bacteria. Second media, that is according to IPBP and USP, is your alternate thioglycolate medium. The difference between a fluid thioglycolate and alternate thioglycolate is this one contains no agar. Still, it will be used for aerobic and anaerobic bacteria. Third one is your soybean casein digest medium. Now, this particular medium is specially used if you are suspecting that your contaminant in your product is a fungi. Okay, so again a highlight is this culture will be used for fungi and as well your aerobic bacteria. Now let's start with our actual experiment of sterility test. Now before you actually start your test, you have to do something called as media suitability test. What do you mean by media suitability test? As the name suggests, we are going to find out whether the media that we have selected for the test is suitable for that particular test. Okay, so first test that we have to do is, we have to make sure is your media is sterile, and second thing that we have to make sure is media supports growth of microorganism. Okay, now how do we make sure that the media is sterile? So what is the general procedure for making media? We weigh all the ingredients, we add it to water, we heat it, we dissolve all the ingredients, we close the mouth of the particular say conical flask or beaker that you have used to make this, and we keep it in an autoclave to sterilize the media. Okay, so at the end of the autoclave cycle, we are expecting that the media is sterile, but we have to make sure that the media is sterile. So what we do is, once we have autoclaved it, we take that media and put it in a petri dish and keep that petri dish in an incubator. After 24 hours, if we see no growth in that particular petri dish, we state that the media is sterile. So I repeat, after autoclaving, if we keep that particular media in an incubator, if no growth is present in that particular petri dish or conical flask, then we state that the media is sterile. Okay, next is we need to find out whether the media supports growth of microorganism. Now this particular test is called as the growth promotion test. Now once we have autoclaved our media, in that media we add a culture of microorganisms and keep it in an incubator. After 24 hours, if we see that there is turbidity in that particular petri dish, we state that yes, the media that we have used is promoting growth of microorganisms. It might be the case that certain components in the media might be inhibit the growth of microorganisms. We don't want this in our sterility test. So that is why we are making sure that our media is promoting growth of microorganisms. So media sterility test can also be called as a negative control. So what is a negative control? Basically, a negative control gives you a standpoint where you claim that the media that you have used was autoclaved properly and there is no growth in an individual media itself. So remember, in your negative control, you have not inoculated your media with microorganisms. It is just plain simple media that you have kept in the incubator and you are trying to find out whether it was contaminated with any microorganism or not. or rather I would state it as whether your autoclave cycle was efficient enough to kill all the microorganisms in the media and make it as a sterile medium. So this particular petri dish that you'll keep without any microorganism will be called as your negative control. Growth promotion test can also be called as the positive control. So what you are doing actually in the positive control, you are taking a sterile media and you are purposely inoculating your sterile media with the microorganisms so that it tells you that the media that you have used is promoting the growth of microorganisms. So whenever you perform any experiment in microbiology, it is very important that you make two sets, with one which is a positive control and one which is a negative control, so that you have a reference standard against which you can compare your test samples. So your sterility test is performed by two methods. First one is called as your membrane filtration and second one is called as your direct inoculation. So I hope you remember what is membrane filtration and direct inoculation. So basically in membrane filtration, you take your solution and filter it through a membrane filter. Then you take that membrane filter and put it on a petri plate which contains your agar or your nutrient medium. If your solution that you have filtered through contains a contaminant such as microorganism, the petri dish after incubation will show you a growth. Okay, in that case we are going to claim that our sterility test has failed. The sample contained microorganism. Okay. So in membrane filtration, which kind of substances you prefer? So if your formulation is an oily formulation, if it's an ointment, if it's a non-bacteriostatic solid, if you have a soluble powder or a liquid, or if the volume of the test of the substance or the volume or volume of the test sample that you want to do is high, then it in that case you will prefer membrane filtration method. In some cases, your formulation that is to be filtered through a membrane is very viscous in nature or very sticky in nature. For example, oil samples or your ointments, they cannot be directly filtered through your membrane filtration. So in that case, you have to first dilute your sample with the help of certain sterile diluent buffers. Example is your fluid A, fluid B, fluid K. The composition and for what it is used for is mentioned in the table that is shown in this particular slide. So this slide basically tells you the method. So you all are aware that a membrane filter has a pore size of approximately 0.45 micron and it has a diameter of approximately 50 millimeters. So, because it has a pore size of 0.45 microns, all your microorganisms are going to get retained on the filter paper and all your solution is going to get filtered through the filter paper. Okay? So, whatever the microorganisms, if they are present in the sample, are retained on the filter paper, you are going to take this filter paper and cut it into two halves. Okay? One half of this filter paper you are going to put it in a fluid thioglycolate medium and the second half you are going to put it in soybean casein digest medium. Now why are you performing this step? Because when you see through the sample, you are not going to come to know whether your sample is contaminated with the bacteria or fungi. So by default you have to put your test sample in both the mediums to check for the growth of bacteria as well as the growth of fungi. Second method is your direct inoculation method. So it's a very simple method. So what you do is you have your sample. That sample could be your ointment, vials, etc. You have to open that sample. Now you have to remember that when you open your sample, it cannot be opened randomly anywhere. You have to open this sample aseptically in a laminar airflow hood. Okay? Because it should not happen that while you are opening your container, you are transferring microorganisms, which could give you a false positive test. Okay? So it is very, very important when you open your sample, it has to be opened aseptically. Okay? Next is, once you have opened a sample, according to the table where we have studied what volume to be used, you are going to take that required volume of the sample and put it into your fluid thioglycolate medium and second half in your soybean casein digest medium. So to test the growth of both bacteria. This slide tells you basically how to interpret your results. So what is going to happen? In first case, if you don't observe any growth in your petri dish or in your flask, then you are directly going to say that your sample which you have selected passes the test of sterility. Good, then you are happy. Okay. In second case, if there is growth that is observed in your petri dish, straight away you are not going to reject your product. Okay. You are going to give the product a second chance, because it might be the case that while you are performing sterility test, you might have introduced organisms accidentally into the product. So that is why if growth is observed, the containers that you have selected to do that particular test are reserved and a retest is again performed as you have done it for the original test. Okay. In this case, if you observe that there is no growth, you will say that the test has passed this time. Okay. If you observe that there is growth, then in this case, you take that petri dish and try to isolate the microorganisms that are grown in that particular petri dish. Okay. Once you isolate, again there are two cases. If they are readily distinguishable from those growing in containers reserved in the first test, again a second retest is performed. In this second retest, if again growth is observed, then you are straight away going to reject that particular test or that particular batch. But if you don't observe growth in this second retest, you are going to pass the sample. Okay? This was the case if your microorganisms were readily distinguishable. But if your microorganisms were not readily distinguishable, then your sample automatically fails the test. Okay?